side, we get assigned different folders to work in order to reach out and speak to those contacts to let them know that they are being monitored. And so our goal at the DPH would be to have the contacts sign up for our automated text messaging program. Obviously that decreases the labor burden on the employees at the Department of Public Health if the contacts would choose to self-monitor via text monitoring. So that was the primary objective, actually, for those of us that are contact tracers, was to talk to the contacts about the benefit to them of being a text monitored contact. And for a variety of reasons, whether they didn't have the technology or didn't want to have the automated process, they would then get funneled into call folders. And so if they were not choosing the text monitoring and they preferred to receive a phone call, then other people would be responsible for the daily phone calls. And then from there, a lot of different things happen. You know, I call it, you know, the outlier list or the naughty list or whatever it might be, for a variety of reasons. People may start complying with the daily text monitoring, but eventually they choose to stop paying attention to the texts. And so that puts them in a not engaged file. People could specifically, you know, refuse to comply and tell us that, you know, this was an infringement on their privacy and they didn't want to be contact traced at all, either via text or phone. And so then that would also put them into a different folder that would warrant a call. And so those were my responsibilities, were calling all of the outliers for the variety of different reasons to try to re-engage them, to try to reassure them that contact tracing was for their benefit as well as the community's benefit, and try to keep them engaged and active in the process so that we would be able to monitor them for the entire time span of their 14 days.
Amanda, I'd love to hear what you have to add to that from a contact tracing point of view and from a case investigator point of view, how that process works.
So similar to what Jill said, just using database cases, people get tested either do different testing sites, and it shows up on our spreadsheet, and we look them up and contact, we'll call them and ask simple questions like pre-existing conditions and what their symptoms were, an onset date. Our main focus is to see what symptoms or what was going on during the time, how long it takes, so we can send that data over so we can see what's going on exactly with our counties, Cobb and Douglas. Also, we try to make sure we focus on the businesses, and now with schools, of course, schools and any outside activity, to make sure that if it's an outbreak, let's get it, let's control it, handle it. So we can make sure that everybody's healthy. And Jill did a really good job of explaining everything, so she pretty much covered, there are people, like she said, who do not want to do it, and we're just trying to make them understand that we're really trying to make sure you're healthy, your family's healthy, everybody else is around there healthy, but we do get those cases as well.
Thank you, ladies. Amanda, we'll stay with you. I would love for you to share a little bit more about some unique experiences you had as a contact tracer and case investigator.
I have a couple. One of the big ones, especially at the beginning, is people not understanding what asymptomatic is. And I think in some situations, people still kind of go back and forth with knowing what that is. I remember having a case that said, I have no symptoms, why am I positive? I said, well, you're asymptomatic, but I have no symptoms. So at that point, it's kind of like educating people that, okay, asymptomatic is somebody who tests positive, but they have showing no symptoms, but they can still spread it to other people. Another one actually has to deal with a group of people having a small party, 5 people, and they went to go, I guess at that time, Beyonce was coming out with her album and they wanted to have a party because, you know, it's Beyonce. And just letting her know that there were some people who were sick there, her son, his girlfriend, and the person who was throwing the party, all up and getting sick, and all the girlfriend ended up in the ICU. So it was kind of her telling, well, after she got sick and the girlfriend got sick, it was kind of letting her know, I know you want to get out there. I know I don't like it either as well, but we got to make sure that everybody's safe. Because even though she's fine, she has other people who had symptoms that were more severe.
Thank you for sharing with us. Jill, can you tell us a little bit about some of your unique experiences as a contact tracer?
Sure. You know, because I got to work the outlier files, I had an opportunity to build rapport with a lot of the contacts that I was tracing, because I would be calling them multiple days in a row over the span of those 14 days. And so for me, the things that stick out are, you know, for some of the people, my call was a bright spot in their day. They looked forward to someone reaching out to them and talking to them and asking them how they were feeling. It felt, you know, it's kind of hard to remember, but back in the, you know, May, June timeframe, we still were all experiencing a lot of isolation and a lot of, you know, sheltering in place still and staying home. So for a lot of the contacts, it was nice to have connection to the outside world. I multiple times have held the space for people as they grieved the loss of a loved one. You know, we're calling people who are contacts, and so that means that someone in their life tested positive for COVID-19. And as we all know, the mortality rate for this disease is very high. And so many of the cases, or so many of the contacts that I reached out to, were actually grieving the loss of a parent or a spouse or a child. I found that they really liked talking with someone who understood kind of the back end of this disease and was really involved with it on a daily basis. And then, you know, I have had everything happen to me, from people swearing at me to threatening me to wanting to find out where I live so that they can come hunt me down. And I've also had people who wish they could give me a virtual hug, or who have prayed over me, or so many different things. And so the whole experience for me was just a curtain behind, you know, to see behind the curtain of humanity. Everyone is dealing with fear and uncertainty, and everyone expresses their fear and uncertainty in a wide array of manners. And as a contact tracer, you know, stepping into people's private lives, we got to be witness to a lot of that. So there's some contacts that I don't call anymore because they're outside of their quarantine period, and I find myself wondering, oh, I wonder how so-and-so is doing, or I wonder if so-and-so's child is feeling better. So there was just a really beautiful side of getting to be among so many different humans during the last few months.
That's, you know, just being in y'all's shoes, I think y'all do have a completely different perspective of contact tracing and talking with individuals. And y'all were doing this in the midst of a pandemic yourselves, that we had not really experienced as a society before. So tell me just, you know, you can maybe elaborate. This is really going off of Randall's question he asked in the chat. He said, did you have face-to-face contact with people? And so tell us a little bit about how you were able to do your job during a pandemic and how that affected your work location and what you were able to do and not able to do. Did you have face-to-face contact?
No. So we worked 100% remote the whole time that we've been doing contact tracing. So aside from my very first day on the job with DPH, where I actually traveled to the district office to receive my laptop, receive my cell phone. That's the only day that I've worked face-to-face with any of the employees from DPH, and obviously no face-to-face contact with any of the contacts or cases themselves. From an internal perspective, we all worked off of Microsoft Teams, or at least my district did. And so I collaborated and worked with all the other contact tracers that were in my district and my supervisor and all the other staff, either through Microsoft Teams or through online trainings and meetings. And then every single interaction with the contacts themselves was over the phone.
Okay. Amanda, did you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, that's pretty much the same. I only see my teammates on Zoom and team calls, but other than that, there's no contact.
Okay. Let's move on to talking a little bit about your degree program and your time as a student. So Amanda, can you tell us a little bit about how being a student in the College of Public Health helped to prepare you for this experience, or how has it shaped, I guess you're going from an academic setting to a professional frontline setting?
I got my master's in health policy and management. So to do EPI, it was completely separate from, but because we do, because public health kind of all talks to each other at one point in a way, they all deal with each other. It was kind of helpful to learn a different avenue. I took EPI, I took a little bit of EPI classes before. So it was kind of a refresher in a way. But being at the school or being in my program, it was a way of kind of connecting the dots of how everything runs and how it starts. So,
thank you. Jill, you want to share a little bit about your, I guess, experience and preparation from an academic student standpoint to working with the Department of Public Health?
Sure. So I focus on community health, behavior, and education. And so contact tracing is obviously tucked up underneath that from a public health intervention perspective. And so a lot of what I did with the contact tracing was educating the community, answering a lot of questions about the disease itself, and also answering questions about health behavior and protocols like mask wearing and hand washing and social distancing and the difference between isolating and quarantining. And so a lot of the contact tracing for me went beyond just identifying whether or not people had symptoms. It was also helping to educate them on, you know, what we're doing, why we're doing it, what the latest research was. I found that I had to always be kind of on the forefront of the peer-reviewed research regarding COVID-19 and the spread of it, because I was constantly being asked questions about, well, I heard this report, or I read this on NPR, or is this true, is that true? And so having the ability to identify, you know, particularly peer-reviewed articles and journals and information coming from reliable and trusted sources, because as we all know, everyone is a public health professional these days, and the ability to trust science and to trust, you know, true information and true data is a little bit of a slippery slope. And so I found that I was doing a lot of reminding people to go to trusted websites, use the CDC website for your source, go to the DPH website. So I was spending a lot of time educating people on how to inform themselves regarding public health as well.
Thank you, Jill. So this experience really sounds like it has been very impactful, not only in your personal life, the challenges, the lessons you've learned, but just kind of in the future. And so how has this experience shaped some of your future plans? What are you currently doing? And what are some of your plans going forward after this experience? Jill, we'll start with you.
Okay, thanks. So when I started my doctoral program in the College of Public Health, my intention, so I'm a breast cancer survivor, and so I've been working with our local population around improving quality of life for breast cancer survivors. And so the train had left the station and I was going 100 miles an hour in the direction of continuing to do programs and interventions to improve the quality of life of our local breast cancer survivors. And then COVID-19 arrives and basically has taken the trajectory of my career and turned it at least 90 degrees right now. I won't say it's a 180, but it's 90 degrees. One of the opportunities that came up as a product of the contact tracing and just the College of Public Health and being surrounded by other public health officials was that we launched an initiative in Statesboro and Bullock County to normalize mask wearing and have really I've had an opportunity to be involved at such a deep level in the community, both with partnering with the city of Statesboro, partnering with the county, partnering with the regional EMA, as well as professors and students at the College of Public Health, that it would feel like a missed opportunity if I didn't place most of my time and energy and effort into continuing to squash the spread, continuing to educate community members around this spread of this infectious disease. And so I've been kind of tap dancing around this, but I still believe that breast cancer will always be my philanthropy, and all the work that I'm doing in the College of Public Health will also benefit our breast cancer survivors. But I definitely am feeling pulled more and more into infectious disease control. And then also, based on the concept of one health, of humans and the environment and animals, mutually interacting with one another, and what we're seeing from a climate change perspective and a human encroachment into wildlife areas, and the origin that we know from where COVID-19 came, I don't think this is going to be the last time we're going to see, an emerging infectious disease like this. And so again, I have a feeling that I am going to be staying in the infectious disease world from here on out, which is fine with me. I love it.
Well, we're excited for you and very proud of the work you've done in Bullock County with Squash the Spread. Thank you. Amanda, let's hear a little bit from you about some of your future plans.
So before COVID became where it is now, I was planning to go to law school for health, to help with health policy. COVID really just pushed that up, because we need something, especially when people losing their job and losing healthcare, people be able to get the care that they need. Right now we're working on vaccinations the need right now, this pandemic showed that we're not in the best position right now as a country, that we need to make some changes. So my goal is to go into law school. I don't want to say go, I am, better statement, to go to law school and try to bridge that gap between access to care, prevention, promoting prevention, of course, and stuff of that nature. Because if anything else, this pandemic showed that we need to make some improvement.
That's very exciting as well. We're excited to see what all you do and your future plans. So let's talk, let's say someone listening today is interested in becoming a contact tracer. What advice do y'all have for them? What do you think, what is something you learned? What was helpful, or some encouragement, maybe things not to do? We'd love to hear from you.
Jill, since you started last. Like I said earlier, just understand everybody doesn't have a health background. So even when I was talking to my family members about epidemiologists, they're like, we don't know what that is. So just understand, when you get on the phone with somebody, it is an educational opportunity to educate them, because they might be looking at Google, and everybody knows when you look at Google, it doesn't always give you the best information. So just having, going into contract tracing, you're providing more than just getting that information, you're giving information as well. So just to make sure to have that in mind.
Yeah, I agree with what Amanda said. And also a couple reminders. So one of the first reminders would be, and I've learned this as well, is that as a contact tracer, you also have the opportunity to be a role model. People know that I contact trace, people know that I'm involved with Squash the Spread. And so there's a little bit of a heightened, I have to make sure that I always have a mask, that I always have a mask on, that I'm practicing what I'm preaching. COVID-19 became very personal for me this summer when a couple of my kids tested positive. So not only was I contact tracing for other people, but I was also experiencing it for myself firsthand. And I saw how hard it is to quarantine. And I realized how challenging it was to have to separate family members from other family members, and the uncertainty of knowing how severe the disease can be, and to know whether or not I was doing the right thing, or behaving the right way, or providing the right resources. And so, you know, just remembering at the end of the day that this is a human disease that's impacting humans. And part of the challenge to go along with what Amanda was saying about policy and about what's happening is that, you know, when you tell a mother or a father that they have to stay home away from work for 14 days and to quarantine, and they are living paycheck to paycheck, and they don't have the ability to take paid sick time off, or they don't have cash reserves to be able to pay their bills or pay their rent, that people are really having to make really challenging decisions that put either their immediate family at risk. I mean, if they don't go to work and they don't make their money and they can't pay their rent, and then they risk getting evicted, versus, you know, whether they should do the right thing for the community. And so when you're trying to convince someone who doesn't have any symptoms, doesn't necessarily feel like they came in contact with someone at a close range who had COVID-19, and we're telling them that they need to stay home and away from work for 14 days, you can only imagine how challenging that decision making must be for them. And so I think any time as a contact tracer, or just as a human being, then we can try just for a microsecond to put ourselves in the shoes of the other person and realize how challenging it is to have to make some of the decisions that we're telling people they have to make, especially when they don't have all of the data and facts and knowledge and information, like Amanda mentioned. We're asking people to do something that's very challenging. So I think that's what's really important to remember, not only as contact tracers, but, you know, as leaders, as professors, as just humans in our community, is just acknowledging what a challenging time this is for everyone on every level.
Thank you, Jill. Amanda, Jill, you know, just got finished talking about how challenging this is, and there were difficult conversations and people didn't understand, but what was the most rewarding takeaway from this experience? What was, I guess, the highlight, the overall impact that it had on you?
When Jill was talking about earlier of her having talked to people who said, I'm glad you're calling, I'm glad somebody's checking up on me, that's rewarding, because I think some people, not all people, but some people who I spoke to felt like they were, okay, you have COVID, stay by yourself, I'm alone. So the fact that you can either talk to somebody, even older people especially, who are isolated for their family, I think it was rewarding to see that. It was rewarding to see that I was being able to help them and have interaction for that day. And for the most part, when they're older people, they're really nice. Well, mostly they're nice. They say they're mostly nice. So it was rewarding to see the change people's day. And like, hey, when I get through that, you're a survivor. Congratulations. Good luck on your future endeavors. So that was rewarding.
Thank you. We're going to move on to our chat. So if you have a question that you would like to ask our two panelists, we encourage you to add it to the chat, and I will go in the order. Let's see. I think we've got one from Angelique Jennings. What can we do as a community to better aid contact tracers? And what information do we need to have if we are exposed to COVID-19 to give to contact tracers? Great question.
I'll take that one. What can you do? You can answer the phone. We can't contact trace people if they don't answer the call, which I understand. You know, I am a phone screener. If a number pops up on my screen and I don't know who it is, I won't answer it. So I don't blame people when they don't answer it the first time, but we always leave a message, and we always ask that they return our calls. And if I make 100 calls in a day, I probably leave 70 voicemails, and I may get one or two return calls from those 70 voicemails that I leave. So if you are involved in contact tracing, either through your Department of Public Health or like Georgia Southern has the CARES contact tracers, just answer their calls. It is a public health service. It is a mandate from our governor, and it is designed to help our community reopen quickly. It's designed to help keep our economy strong. It's, you know, contact tracing is designed to be beneficial to everyone. So that would be the main thing that I would say is, you know, answer the calls. And so, Amanda, I don't know if you want to take the second part of that question or not.
Going back to what you say, answer the call. There's been commercial for contract tracers, but I haven't heard a commercial for case investigators. So we're kind of like the ugly stepsisters, I guess, in this situation. But for us, we do call as well. We leave a voicemail and we send a text to be like, we're real, please answer the phone. We're trying to help. And for information, depending on, most of the information is the same throughout Georgia. Go to your local, you can go to the CDC, but if you don't want to go to the Common Douglas or the Butler or wherever you're from, Department of Public Health. The first thing you see, of course, would be COVID, and they have a bunch of information to help you and your family.
Thank y'all. We've got another question that I got. This one is talking more about mental health, based on your observations as a contact tracer and case investigator. So how has the pandemic affected the mental health of individuals based on your observations and your roles at the Department of Public Health?
So we actually had a meeting about mental health on both ends, just for us and for the people who we talked to as well. Of course, we take breaks when we need to, because you can have that call that's yelling at you, and then you can have that call. I had a call that I called the daughter. He died the day before, so I never got to talk to him. That was emotional. Or you talk to other family members who are dealing with that as well. And then people are scared. So in a way, you're a counselor. Just trying to be like, it's going to be okay. You're doing well. We're going to get through this together. Also, for my calls, I say, hey, if you need to call me, my phone's right here. Just call me if you need something. Just let me know. I could get you something if need be.
Yeah, I would add that was kind of a fine line, because we aren't trained mental health professionals, but we are building relationships and rapport with people. And we have, you know, I think what I found is most contact tracers are very compassionate humans already. And so wanting to be able to support and help people in general, you know, so we would, my personal area of, you know, influence is always around self-care. So making sure that people are, you know, eating right and sleeping well and drinking their water and spending time out in nature and relying on whatever, you know, self-care practices that they have, between, you know, meditation or prayer and physical activity, and just reminding people that even if you are home and even if you're isolating or quarantining, as long as your symptoms allow you to be active, making sure that you're, you know, getting up every day, getting out of your bed, getting, you know, dressed or taking showers, or just some of the basic self-care steps that are necessary to keep people feeling like they're functioning. And then also being able to point people in the direction of different mental health resources that are available to them in their community. And, you know, I spent a lot of time looking up different resources for different people spread throughout the district, just making sure that they, you know, knew what was available to them and how to be able to access it. But I think that's important information for everyone right now, as things are so different, is just making sure you are prioritizing your healthcare and well-being.
Thank you. That's a very important just thing that I know that y'all dealt with personally, your own personal mental health, and also those you talk to. So very eye-opening. We've got another question in our chat from Vic. He says, as a clinical health social worker in the public health certificate program, I am hearing an overlap of skills and knowledge I used in both of your roles. Do you agree? Sounds like a place for public health social work. What are your thoughts on that?
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
Definitely. Social work will help, especially when we talk about the mental part. And like Jill, I didn't even mention this, so I'm glad you, if you can't get up, get up. Somebody talking to you can make their day. So just somebody checking up on you can help.
Yeah, I think Amanda alluded to it earlier. You know, our entire medical system needs an overhaul, and we need, you know, more normalization of mental health support, and also recognizing that, you know, a global pandemic is a very stressful and unusual time for people from so many perspectives, between, you know, creating financial burden to relational burden to its increasing instances of domestic violence. And we're seeing, you know, a rise in a lot of the other statistics that point to the fact that, you know, our mental health is deteriorating. And so I think any time that we can incorporate more social work, more mental health resources and support, especially in these unusual and very trying times, I think it's very, very important.
Thank you. Yes, it sounds like there's a multiple disciplines that your experience has touched. You, I know y'all mentioned counselor. I also heard, you know, the social work. There's a little bit of psychology in there, health education, definitely law. You can link it to that, Amanda. So is there anything else? We'll leave it open still for questions, but I'm going to go back to y'all. If there's anything else you wanted to add, if there's anything else you wanted to share before we conclude this event.
One of the things that I've made this shift in my script over the last month or so is at the end of every call, I've been thanking the person on the other end for participating in contact tracing. And I know that might sound trivial, I really want to reinforce to people that they're choosing to participate in this public health intervention of contact tracing. And if all the streaming services now have documentaries about the 1918 influenza outbreak or whatever, but, you know, if you look at how we mitigated the spread of HIV/AIDS in the 80s and early 90s, that contact tracing is a tried and true public health intervention. And I think, ending each of my calls with that, with all the people that I spoke to, you could kind of hear the lift in they're like, oh, you know, you're welcome. I guess I am doing my part. I am doing my thing. And so I think, you know, it's like back in World War II, like buy your bonds, be patriotic, like participate in this thing that we're doing. And I found that to be a really pleasant way to end all of my calls and conversations. And so I do that now too around the community. When I see someone wearing their mask, I have a tendency to want to point out the people that aren't complying with mask wearing. But I find that when I, thank people for wearing their masks, or I thank students on campus, or, reminding ourselves to be appreciative to the people that are taking this seriously and that are doing their part, because sometimes we just feel beat down by what we're not doing or by what other people aren't doing. And so a little bit of gratitude and appreciation goes a long way.
Thank you. Amanda, did you have anything to add, or can you see the question in the chat box? Okay, I'll read it for everyone who's viewing. Wearing masks became political and is political. At times, information from the government became inconsistent. Did you hear about this firsthand in your phone interactions, and how did you handle this?
So especially when it came for wearing masks and not wearing masks, at the beginning of my calls, not as much now, But when it was like, don't wear a mask, wear a mask, there's a lot of people saying this is a fake, this is a fraud, this is, it's not true, you know, you're not getting your information correct, how are we supposed to know? And what I kind of tell them, I said, this happened, we're all learning this. This is not like the flu that's been around for a while. This is not like something that's, oh, this is a pandemic that we were not planning for. So wearing a mask, though it may be uncomfortable, it's better to wear a mask and you will can be okay than not wear a mask and put yourself out there for a disease. So it's kind of like a prevention, public health, preventing you from getting disease. So that's how I usually go after it.
And I can add, so our local Squashing the Spread Bullock initiative, we're actually using public health models and theory to help us mitigate some of that. And so we've been using what's called diffusion of innovations, which I know there's so many public health people on this call, but really looking at the messaging that certain people are anchored to, and then figuring out how to tailor the intervention to be able to almost like combat or counteract that particular message with our own messaging, but using their language and their words. And so, you know, there's been a couple over the last 4 months, we've seen a lot of faith over fear. We've seen, you know, a lot of the you know, it's an infringement on my freedom and some of those kind of things. And so, you know, with Squashing the Spread and with some of the other things we've been doing, we've been adopting that language and saying it's very patriotic and it's, you know, doing your part by wearing a mask. And so coming back at those who might be pushing back from a political perspective or from a particular angle, using their own language, just because as public health professionals, we know that that's how you get people to change their behavior. And so I think, and to answer, I mean, I think the part about inconsistent information coming from the government, one of the things that we know as researchers is that we are constantly chasing hypotheses and we're trying to prove or disprove them. And it's never, nothing is ever done and nothing is ever complete. And so with public health, we do expect to do more research and we do expect to get more knowledgeable and we do expect scientists to change their mind and change their opinions as they become more knowledgeable and as the data and research proves it. And so I think that's one of the angles that we took as well of, you know, we are learning more and more about this disease every single day. We, you know, this is something that has only been on our radar now for 6 months. And so the thoughts and views and beliefs we had back in March, we would expect them to be different today in, you know, September. And that's what we want our scientific community to be doing, is teaching us and learning more and proving more things. And so I think that piece around the inconsistency is a part that I always would promote as being a positive thing. Like, we are learning more, and that's what science and public health scientists do. And then as far as the messaging, just, you know, using their language to help them understand how and why to do their part.
Thank you, ladies. Well, I'm gonna wrap up our discussion today. It has been great. I know that the two of you have experience and insight that some of us as public health professionals and even community members, we haven't had the opportunity to see this, but you have really stepped up to the plate when there was a need in our community and in our state to work with the Department of Public Health in the midst of a pandemic. I know your own personal lives were probably flipped upside down, and y'all really stepped up to work on the front lines for this, and we appreciate that, and we're proud of you. I do, there is one more question from Dr. Mace. Do you think there are opportunities to get the state government to set better standards for mask use? Do y'all see that in the future?
Not anytime soon. It would be nice. It would be nice, but it seems that each state is kind of going by what they think would be best for their state. So mm-hmm. If it was like mandatory, everybody wear a mask, but right now it just seems like you can choose which way you want to go.
So maybe you do your job and you wear your mask. So that's what the message we will send. But thank you for that. All right, well, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Telfair to close us out.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Cromley, for your moderating, and thank you, Ms. Johns and Ms. Atkins, for your phenomenal work. I'm just going to post a hand clapping. You know, everybody can post a hand clapping, you know, for this. So thank you very much, very much. So just a couple things. We will have a very similar seminar. We'll have another seminar this time next week. And if you can attend that, that would be fantastic. It's another set, as I mentioned earlier, another set of our phenomenal students. And they will build on what we learned today. We are all appreciative of the pretty practical information that we've heard, as well as the work. And then just how science works in practice. I also would want to just remind everyone that we do have another seminar series, that a companion series that Dr. Fung leads from his department. If you could make sure you will see the flyer that comes out all the time, and I would encourage you to consider attending his seminar as well. So having said all that, thank you so very much for this. One of the things that we value here is feedback. So please take a moment, if you can, give us feedback on our seminar. We work hard very much to promote this work that the students do, the faculty do, our partners do, in terms of working with us, and we're always appreciative of that. So having said that, I will end this seminar, and I want to thank you all for taking out the time for an hour of your day to do this, and we will see hopefully everyone back on the seminar next week. Thank you so very much. Bye.